Good morning to all. Today we will continue the part on the D3.js, and we will start instead looking a little further on how to create our solution. So we reviewed in the last two lessons the general concept, and what we will see today will be a brief recap of what we saw the last lesson, very brief. Then we will start talking instead of more elements concerning data visualizations and how to govern specific aspects that concern representation, because we didn't fully get all of them in terms of layouts, scales, axes, SVG examples. Those four concepts should allow us in the end to be able to recreate initial simple form of visual representation, like line chart, bar chart, scatter plots, and similar one. Okay, so visual representation paradigms that are quite easy from the geometric point of view, but that are make general with respect to what we expressed in the last two lessons. And concerning the recapping, eventually, what we briefly saw is how to govern selection of elements. Right now, we learned that all of the D3 code is based on selections, and eventually how to govern each of them depending on how many elements we need to get. Then we looked at how to bind the data to those elements, both visually, so managing the binding between data elements and visual elements, and how to govern the exact matching that we said at every moment we need to guarantee in order to have an exact, a correct update of our visualization, and look at the special enter and exit selection that, if combined in a good way, can allow us to always have our visualization completely driven by our data. And this already you have in the previous slides. And eventually we saw that all of this just prepared the way to really update the visualization. So we look at how we can modify it in order to append the new visual elements on it, and or to remove visual elements from it, depending on what happened. This eventually provided us an overview of the fundamentals, okay? But we still have to keep in mind that what we want to get in the end is a system, in the end, that respect this cycle that was introduced to you by Professor Santucci at the beginning. And this cycle is not necessarily tied to the kind of consideration that we made. Eventually, kind of consideration that we made lied for the most part here to this moment. Okay, so how the library work, the library clearly support a lot the visual aspect. Eventually, some part of user interactions, how to govern it, and something that came from the data that we saw at the end of last lesson, so how to input data for it. But we see that instead our scenario is much bigger, and from now on we will start looking at the D3.js led by this scenario, because this is the thing that in the end we want to create. And at the beginning we will look particularly at the first part of this cycle, that is, the part that starts from the data and eventually allow us to map the data to visual paradigm. But as you can see, we are neglecting pretty much all the rest of the cycle. So just these two elements. We will see, going deeper into this story, how we will more and more enrich our coverage. On top of it, I want even to stress that we want to implement this, and to implement this, depending on what you want to create at the end, there are a set of initial activities concerning the domain that you want to attack, the problem you want to attack, the task that a user will eventually do with the system that we want to design, and eventually breaking down the general problem more and more specific, and then Clearly, at some point, attaching the visual representations that we want to attach to each specific task that the user has to solve. I want to say that I will not repeat this part because the professor told me that he already introduced you to this kind of design. So we will take it as granted. So from now on, we have to consider that we already looked at eventual domain, we split up the task, and now we are to the problem of creating this story, okay? So creating the visual environment that support the design that we created, okay? So we will never get back to the design, but we will take it as a precondition. Eventually, if you have doubts on it, you can ask a question and or refers to the material that was already presented. So we are the designer at this point. We have made all of these story. We have this very good design document that tell us what data are important, what is important to look at the data, which will be the user that will look at the data, what you want to do with it, how we have or she have to interact with it in order to get this capability. And we have all of these things written on paper, okay? Maybe we even choose already the visual paradigm for each of the elements that we want them. We choose the kind of interaction that has to happen, maybe not necessarily detailed up to the last fine point, but at the same time, set in stone in terms of visual representation. And now we have to move and create the environment. And the first problem that we will have in creating the environment is to choose how we want to lay out all those visual paradigms, all those user interface elements into a screen that eventually allow us to introduce the original problem. So normally we have a screen size, and the screen size we will get for granted that is a desktop screen of a resolution minimum of full HD. Okay, so we will never take into consideration lower resolution, and then you are free to consider upper one if available or if good for you. And eventually, the first task is to split the space of this screen in order to have our visual elements good represented into this screen. Normally, this part of the job is completely static, or most of the time refers to static code, usually pure HTML code that, like you see in this figure, start to, in principle, fill the screen with areas. We already learned that in order to create a visualization, we need an SVG area and a div resulting that eventually encompasses it, okay? And eventually, you have all the freedom possible in choosing the layout. What you see here is an example. But what I suggest is, instead of starting first pulling in visualization and then see what happened, and maybe just at the end start playing with the layout, trying to envision a layout immediately and eventually create a result in code that is exactly like this one. So simply fill the areas that maybe have nothing inside it, there's just a div with an ID and maybe a text inside that allow you at the beginning to play with the layout. Additional rules will be that, as reported even in this slide. Please consider the first rule that we will introduce now and will be mandatory for the project, but in general is, let's say, very reasonable in life, so not only for this project. This rule, that we will call it rule one, is that all the elements of the environment must be fully contained into a single, yeah, there is an error, sorry, a single viewport. For us, a single viewport is the full screen at the resolution that the user will get, okay? What does it mean with it? It means that it has to resemble something like this, even if the order is completely at your disposal. So it has not to do with five areas and one has to be horizontal and one vertical, whatever. Absolutely not. But we avoid scrollable environments, so full visual list of elements that, for example, can be very well modeled when some of you, or maybe lots of you, work and maybe with Jupyter notebooks or whatever, where you have this very long scrollable analysis where you never get the full overview of it, but you have to follow it sequentially in the sequence that the in that case, the analyst truth. This is probably good when I have to expose a full data analysis process. This is very, very bad when I want a visual analytic system. And the reason is pretty much lies in the fact that if I have to scroll something, I lose context with the link, with the new element that I see, with the rest of the environment. I never get the capability to see the full environment altogether. And so, for example, if I have selection that projects the results on other part of the environment or whatever, I completely lost them. Okay, and so we will not accept it. And what I mean is that we will consider this an error if made in the final assignment, so of a scrollable elements, because it is detrimental to the data exploration that pretty much a very good chunk of visual analytic system have to provide. I report even an example. Here we see an example of one of the projects last year that is considered a very good example. You could see how you could immediately understand what layout it used. The whole story is represented here. This project is about analysis of air pollution data. I'm sorry for the projector. I don't know. It's very sensible. And eventually, the full environment that Mirano is even a complex one, we can recognize at least 5 different visual paradigms, of which at least one of them is quite complex, so composed inside of a different one, plus an area, an horizontal area for general commands and maybe legends and whatever. So this is an example of what a visual analytics system from a layout point of view should do. On the other hand, instead, much more graphically, without a system to provide, this is an example of bad implementation. Why? I have probably the same similar part, still 5 areas, still one horizontal command area. So the system can be considered, even if in its abstract form, completely comparable in terms of functionality with the other. You could eventually even try to imagine how the other could be here, but eventually here I can never see the whole things together. So the very moment I start interacting maybe with something on the top, I don't know what happened on the bottom, and vice versa, and I have to continuously scroll. It's not reported here, but clearly vertical scroll is already a problem. And eventually, if some of you really want and really consider it absolutely needed, have to clearly justify us our, and clearly justification is not simply because I like it, because text is readable, because in my opinion it's more ordered. This is completely unacceptable reasons, okay? On the other hand, apart from my knowledge, if there will be an incredible user requirement or story that eventually demonstrates us that the scrolling is something completely usable to the system, at that point we could consider it. But clearly it will ask person to really have to justify it, okay? So general rule is that we always want the full environment inside the viewport. And I want to add that if, for example, some of you, when doing this, could think about like, oh, maybe I don't read well the legend, or maybe I don't read well the elements, those are design problems, okay? So it does not mean that it's not possible to look at them. It simply means that maybe the original design decision is not good enough, and so does not represent well those data, and corrective action must to be done. But again, it will quite never be a problem of saying, the space is not sufficient, okay? So I need to scroll because I can have my text big enough to be. Eventually, this is even the easiest part of the story because it is done completely into static code, simple HTML code. And this has an advantage, or at least 2 advantages. First of all, it completely detaches your work from the full environment to concentrate on single elements. Why? Because each single element is logically detached from the rest. It has its space, it has its SVG area, its canvas, its easy reobtainable ID of the whole div that encompasses. And so you have a clear separation of it. If tomorrow you choose that this is not the visual paradigm that you like, you can simply substitute that part of code, substitute with another one, and don't have to touch the rest of the code. Instead of, for example, starting working not on a well-separated area, but simply on a full free-form canvas where everything is related, and if I start touching the code, I will probably destroy, I have to touch all of it. The second part is that at the beginning you will define a layout, and maybe it will be even well-crafted. But it could happen during work, the sum of those decisions could require revisions. Okay, why? Because maybe you devoted less area than expected to some of the visualization, because maybe some of it you thought they were too simple, and maybe you need additional UI elements or additional interaction to make them more efficient. Or eventually, because new visual paradigm, like I said before, could come to mind that are better suited, and maybe we want them added completely into the environment. In this story, what it is interesting is that if well separated, the capability to revise the layout is only a capability to start working with the CSS of each of the area. Okay, so that, again, I don't have even at this point to touch the code if the visual elements remain the same, and only to reshape how they get layout inside my area. So here, for example, we have the same components of before, but in a way in which maybe now the layout is different and tends to have a more vertical fashion on the left and keep more space for what was a little less constrained before in terms of space. Interestingly, if done in this way, obtaining this version from the last one is just a problem of changing the CSS properties of the elements and not touching even a single line of code inside the element themselves. So this is very important, and given that during last edition of the course, this was an overlooked part, this year we put it at the front, and I want even to say that I will be very happy when we will explain you the exam rules, that the initial layout, even if changeable at a later stage, so not set in stone, should be provided into the initial proposal of the work. Okay, so in order to let you start considering it and not coming then to exam with very fancy solution that eventually violate the rule that I already given. And as I told you, this is completely static. So but the 3.js doesn't do pretty much anything here. Normally you are in the body part of the HTML page, not even in the script part. And you start statically defining the areas, in this case, the div that will contain this element. I want even to stress that in that part, only the div, honestly, should be defined and not directly even the SVG areas. We already saw in the last, in all the examples that we saw now, that we can procedurally create an SVG area given a div, and this still is the best way to do it. Okay, the reason is quite simple. Given the nature of the tree, if we create and destroy the area every time, we have a general code that whatever happened in the div behind, we always be able to redraw from scratch the story. If instead we keep a fixed SVG area, for whatever reason we delete it during the code, immediately we lose completely the capability to redraw it again, because we don't have anymore in the code the line that create the area itself. Okay, so while in principle some of you could be led to define even SVG area in this phase of the layout, this is wrong from a code point of view. In this part, we will never use a fixed SVG area, we will just define the properties of the div encompassing the whole story. And then during the code, we will retain the div as we saw in all the example that we got. And the first step all the time will be to create the area that will fill it and will be put as a base. Additionally, I want even to say that, for example, if in a div I have a subpart of it that have to have an SVG area and another that have to be, for example, UI element, this is more general to me in order to manage even this coexistence and not having to start asking me where do I have to put the UI that has nothing to do with SVG. Additionally, another instead little aspect that start to devise more. So right now we have even the layout. So we have again this our document, but now we have even a set of areas that a set of div that have to encompass. Okay. And we have exactly this problem. That now procedurally, depending on where we want to start, we will start designing in the tree this time how the element must work. So how the visual paradigm at the beginning of the visual encoding that we choose have to be represented into the tree. And the very first problem is to define the SVG area itself. Up to today, we saw all examples in which we just have to put it there with a quite fixed item width and be happy with it, okay? And we never thought about what does it mean and if it was the correct way. Normally, we can clearly say that that was not the correct way. That was a very hard-coded way of doing it, okay? And it is for at least two reasons. The first one is that when we will get to accommodate the area, we will have those areas represented in terms of what they are in the layout. But when we get them on the screen, they could result in very different length and height, depending on which screen we open this page. So you see, if it is in the target resolution display, they will be exactly what we expect. But maybe we don't know exactly the number of pixels. Maybe we know that these are pretty much 50% of the horizontal occupation, but who knows how much does it mean in terms of pixels, okay? And this is the first rule. And if we put it on the screen, there will be different answer on a phone screen and what. On the other end, the second and more important element is that the SVG area represents to us the full extent of area in which we will draw something. And we cannot draw anything outside it, while we can draw only inside. Saying like that will be an easy concept, but in the end it has some drawbacks, some pitfalls if not done right. Let's see at this slide. The first problem initially is the positioning of elements inside an area. An area in itself is always represented as an absolute area. What does it mean? Each area exists on its own, okay? And the way in which it works in terms of obtaining coordinates of elements is motivated by computer graphics. What does it mean? It means that the origin of the b-dimensional coordinate space is always in the top left corner. And while the horizontal counting is completely similar to what we normally do in the Cartesian plane, so it moves from left to right, the vertical axis works the opposite, okay? So when you specify an eigenvalue, you are specifying instead a part that is low in the low part of the vertical axis. Eventually, we can clearly say that the vertical axis is reverted when we look at it. These are the implication in creation of pretty much all the chart that we have to create. Why? Because we normally are used to see the Cartesian plane with the vertical axis pointed in the opposite way, okay? So we have to remember that these are implications in the way in which we govern the famous mapping that we are very happy last time, and that today we see that it gets a little more complicated. The second part concerns, as I already told you, the dimension of it, okay? As you can see here we have the snippet of code that, for example, go put an area inside the body itself. But eventually, if we have defined our layout inside of the body, here we have the ID of the div in which we want to accommodate it or whatever. We go to append the area, and very fastly here, only the mandatory element of the area are represented. An area is always centered, as I told you, in the top left part of whatever element it contains, the area, and it just asks for the width and the height. Those elements here at this moment are not anymore number, but are variable. Why they are variable? Because we need to remember, in order to get a correct rendering, that those quantities must be read dynamically by the page itself, okay? And here there is the initial tricky story. JavaScript, this is done normally using vanilla JavaScript functions, okay? And it exists a lot of those functions. The function that read the width, function that read the outer width, the inner width of elements, there is a plethora of them. And the interesting part is that unfortunately, their behavior is different depending on the browser used. Okay, so different browsers can allow or disallow some of them, and sometimes can even interpret differently the results of those functions, meaning that if I call the same function to read the width of a div inside Chrome or inside Firefox, depending on how I read it, I could obtain a slightly different bit. Now, for our project, this will not be a problem, okay? Why? Because you will have to specify to us what is your target browser, or maybe what is normally called the best viewed in, okay? So we don't want that you lose too much time in trying to adapt this story to the jungle of web technology, but we are not against it. So if you are able to get a very general story, we are more happy, even if it will not be considered an error if you specify what is the target browser in which it works. At the same time, instead in more general conditions, sometimes it requires to read at the beginning even the agent that is reading the system, and based on what agent is returned, so normally the idea of the browser, have the kind of branch of code that best manage. So first story, we always have to go give those characteristics, not anymore statically, but dynamically read by the page. And it is done completely in vanilla JavaScript. The second more important aspect is represented in this figure. When we have created this area, we will have the origin exactly at 0.0, okay? So exactly the top left element of the code. If we start drawing something near this point or near the two axes that we have here, depending on how we manage it, we could have the element completely contained in the area, or we could have the element cutted, so what is normally called clumped, by the border of the area itself. One of the most general examples that we'll see is if I start creating, for example, a very simple line chart, and I have maybe the vertical axis that is centered on this part, what I will obtain will be that the axis will be visible, the chart will be visible, but maybe the tip of the axis will fall outside the area. They are still present in the DOM, they are still there, so there is not an error in code or whatever that stopped me to do it, but they get clumped by the area. Why? Simply because the library does not enforce this behavior. What does it mean is that it takes it as a resilient way to not destroy a page if the designer makes wrong assumption. But what is the result is that the designer will not see what expect and maybe will not even relate to the problem itself, thinking that maybe the element is not there. And believe me, looking for elements that are not visible in the DOM when the environment starts to get complex cannot be a trivial activity if not done right. So normally the second standard things that get done after having created the area is to immediately create what is normally called an active area of draw. And it is done with the second snippet of code. That is, again, is quite general, but it requires a little of our attention. Semantically, what this does is exactly what is visible in the figure, okay? So it translates the origin from its, stand default point to a point that is inner. And then how much is inner is dependent on what we do. And it has to do with the concept of defining margins. Okay, so the lesson learned is that we have always to manage margins explicitly, where margins are not the margin of the div that will be managed normally in pure CSS code, but are margin inside the SVG area that create a safe space for element to get this still visible, okay? Here, what we will get is that the origin will be moved, and it will be this would be interesting in its way. But if it will be only the origin, we will be really in trouble, because the origin itself is not enough to do it. We don't want simply the origin translated. We eventually want the full set of elements inside this area translated. Okay, because if I just translate only the origin, I will have a completely inconsistent draw at this point. Well, if it is a line chart, all the drawing elements remain where they are, and only the origin is semantically. For this reason, we introduce a new element that exists into the SVG standard, and then it's used 2D3 to govern this part. So not simply to translate the origin, but to translate the origin and all the elements that has to be drawn inside it, even if they are not present now, okay? It manages even the fact that at the beginning no visual element would be there. And it's the concept of the element called G that stands for group. G is an element of the SVG standard, exactly like the SVG area and the circles that we already saw, that has no equivalent visually. Okay, so it is an abstract element, and it is an element that allow to group together all the elements that are drawn inside it. Okay, so it's like a hierarchical grouping that if created, if I create a G and start drawing inside it, by retaining the G itself, I will be able to retain the full hierarchy of visual elements drawn inside this G. So if, for example, there, then I have axes, lines, labels, or whatever inside it. If I simply choose to retain the G as the handler, I will be able to apply whatever transformation to all the elements that are inside this group, okay? And so we see that it's very useful, because we saw that without it, we have to retain all the elements one by one, or by classes, or by IDs. In this way, we can retain whatever it is inside. And when we have to put G, depends on us, okay? So it is not mandatory in itself. But we will take as a rule that in order to be able to immediately retain the full element of the visualization, of each visualization that will get created, after having created the SVG area, we will immediately append to the SVG area AG. What it is interesting is that we don't have to specify an area, an extension for it, given its abstract nature. It is not a geometric element. A group retains the full area of the element on which it is appended, okay? And normally it is appended most of the time on a geometric element, okay? Not necessarily an area. It could be, for example, appended even to other geometric element of the SVG standard. But normally it's very rare to have a G appended to another G. It's very unusual given its nature of working. So as you can see here, and it even demonstrates something interesting. Here we are using two variables for detaching this code. This code could have been written in line. So we could have appended directly the dot append at the end of the fix. But sometimes, in order to be more clear on what we do in the code, we could choose even this other part where we retain it in a variable and we use the variable as the next operation. We take the result of the appended area that right now is this one, this full one. We append a G and immediately obtain an area that is again completely containing this, even if the G itself is not in itself an area. The area remains the original one, okay? But the G is overimposing on it, saying that at this moment we have a grouping element that will take whatever is drawn into this area. We don't have to specify anything for the G, Normally, we will specify an ID for all these elements, otherwise we will not be able to retain them, but this is pretty standard web technology, so it is completely transparent in V3. And then as you can see here, in order at this moment to get those margin, we apply a geometric transformation. How do we apply it? Again, as a property. So we call again the dot attr function. This time we don't pass, or maybe we pass a property, the transform property. That is a property that have all the elements inside a web page that allow to apply very basic geometric transformation like translation, rotation, zooming, and similar ones. So purely geometric one. We pass the transform. We pass again a string that is a composition of the transform that we want to apply. So a translate that take us input as a parameter, two dynamic parameters. And in this case are two variables that we have defined somewhere in our code that defines our margins. Okay, eventually even a vector of margin that, of which then we will retain the single margin. And what we obtain is that the original area will stay the same. We'll stay where we put it, but the grouping part will get translated in this case exactly of the margin that we specified, allowing us to have the famous buffer space in our visualization that will avoid at this moment to get clumped elements. Interestingly, what it gives us for free is that we don't have at this moment to specify spaces with respect to this new coordinate element. We will still reason in terms of the absolute coordinate element. So for us, this will still be 0, 0, will not be 20, 20, and we have to do by hand the translation every moment we want things arranged. We have translated the absolute way of working that will get transparent if done in this way. And from that point on, we will again can start drawing, considering this as the original absolute area. On the other end, we get for free the capability to not have our element clamp. Please consider that these two steps are pretty much present in every drawing that we will put there. There could be special cases, but eventually these are pretty standard way of initializing a drawing into an environment. So you will find it quite similar to it pretty often in all the view that will be added to your visual analysis environment. Why they are important? They are important because they allow us to start reasoning on what we can do there. And they introduce a problem that is much more general, and it's the problem of linking the geometric behavior of elements to their data. If you remember, we saw in the last lesson how we could start to give this behavior to the element, but we were in a very relaxed scenario. We had all our space available, and here we saw how can it still be true? Because with this way, we are simulating the fact that this view is taking the full space, even if instead it is very constrained in a specific space into the page. We were at the same time not following any particular visual pattern. We had those circles in the space without any general rules of visual representation. They were just circles. They could have been marked in a geomap, maybe, but no more than that. And we assigned them directly. So we have our data, and was not important what the data represented at the beginning were pure numbers, so without any semantic with respect to the data. So simple numbers. And even in the final case that we saw for data loading, quite strangely, they were directly geometric quantities. Okay, so they were exactly positioning coordinate that were loaded, something that we will never have it, because in the end I could have a list of persons, list of friends, list of evaluation metrics on some e-shops or whatever. I will never get the position directly in a geometric space. This will make no sense. So we have in front the problem of governing instead this second mapping that is as much as important as the initial one that we introduced. We introduced a way to bind the behavior of visual elements to data elements, but we didn't provide the bounds to this behavior. Okay, right now it's completely free. And being free is interesting because allow us to test it, but it's very unusual because it simply is not manageable in its pure form. For these reasons, D3 provides a set of functions that are normally categorized under the concept of scales. And this concept is born exactly this time to govern the mapping from the data attributes to the visual attributes. Okay, we are quite changing the scenario we expected before. Before we were joining simply data to visual elements. Right now we don't want just to do simply that, but we want to govern in a more structured way the geometric behavior of the visual attribute, still coming by the data, okay? And normally it has to be done to the visual attribute this time, not simply to visual elements, but all the single attributes that govern the visual element themselves, that eventually enrich this story because we pass from a single mapping to a multiple mapping, depending on how many attributes we have on the data and on how many attributes we have on the visual elements. And I want even immediately to say that the most limiting for us is the visual attribute, because the visual attribute answer implicitly to a geometry constraints, okay? So they are not infinite. While instead, the data attribute could be derived in any. And at this point, this mapping that immediately becomes richer has even to respond to specific geometric rules of the visual encoding chosen. Okay? So for example, we know that if we create a Cartesian plane, maybe done only on the first quadrant, we cannot position elements in other quadrants. Okay, because it has no meaning, they are outside of the visualization. But this rule, if we stop here and we take the last code that we give, it's not enforced, okay? So we don't have an enforcer that say, please don't position a point outside the axis because it is wrong. If maybe we take an outlier that we didn't foresee, it could completely go there. And eventually, still have a completely syntactic functioning system, but a semantically questionable system. The same is true in a pie chart. What does it mean if I create here a pie and then I have another data point outside the pie? Doesn't mean anything, but does not mean that it is enforced by the draw, and eventually with the instrument that we have to now, we could create exactly this. That is a semantically no meaning. And the more you go on, think about tree maps, think about Sankey diagram, think about Chorus diagram. Those are all visual representation that respond to a specific constraint coming from the geometry that is inherently tied to the visual encoding, okay? Again, those rules does not exist by themselves at the beginning. At the beginning, there is no rules in our just created SVG area, and we need to have a way specify those rules. And this is done exactly by exploiting the concept of scales. What is a scale in its general definition? A scale is a function that allows to tie together, so to create a relation between two main elements that right now in abstract form will define as a domain and a range, okay? So normally a scale take as input a domain and a range, whatever they are. We are not interested at this moment defining a scale what nature have those two sets, and simply define an association relation, okay? So allow us to associate all the elements that come from a domain to all the elements that are in a range in this exact direction. Okay, so it's not bidirectional, at least in its pure definition. Again, we don't put any constraints in the nature of the domain of the range. What does it mean? It means that the both domain and range can be from data, both domain and range can be from visual elements, and more generally, instead, the more general, very useful capability that we have is that one of them is on the data space and the other is in the visual space. Okay? Why? Because it allows us to create these relations. Clearly, normally, all the scale allow to define an inverse method. This is interesting. They provide a way to revert themselves. Semantically, it creates the exact inverse. Syntactically, they create the opposite scale. Okay? Eventually, in order to allow us to work on it, a scale, again, has a double nature. And this is the first of the element in the tree that present a double nature. So a scale is both an object and a function. Okay? When used as a function, it creates in its basic form this mapping. It can be used as an object, meaning that it takes the original function, gets a method invoked on it, and it obtains a different behavior that normally is related to its function nature. Okay? This is the first element in the library that have this behavior, and we will see that many other have this behavior, okay? All the functions that we saw up to today does not have this behavior. Appending, inserting, removing, binding, and selecting works normally only as functions. On the other hand, scales works both as functions and objects inside the library. Normally, their behavior is optional, but believe me, you will never be able, at least in this course, I think, to create a full visualization without relating to them. Why? First of all, because they are very useful, so they mask us a lot of the problems that I told you before, so it's very useful to use them. Second one, because if we choose to not use them, and there could exist cases which could be reasonable, we have to create the whole geometric constrained behavior by ourselves, meaning sometimes implementing complex mathematical equations that govern a particular layout. I made you already two examples. The people interested can go look at the original tree maps paper that is, I think, from 1994. This is defined in terms of geometric equation that govern that space filling layout. So it's pure maths. If tomorrow I want to create a tree map inside the tree, I can choose to relate to this behavior done by scales and even other forms that we will see, or eventually I can simply start re-implementing from scratch those equations that eventually are a mapping. On the other hand, instead, if I choose to use the scale, I can better structure my code and eventually I can exploit their behavior. Let's see how they work. Why? Because scales are not one function, but are a family of functions where different scales are useful for different reasons. And let's start by the initial grouping of scales, so the quantitative scales. As the name say, the grouping of a scale depends on the nature of its domain and range. Okay, and normally domain and range, not considering from where they come, from data or from visual space, can accommodate usually at maximum two kinds of quantities. So continuous quantities or discrete quantities, okay? Then we are not interested in the inner range if those discrete quantities are quantization of a continuous interval or if they are categorical type of products or they are Boolean elements. Again, in the end, we have continuous and we have discrete. And the quantitative scale has as a precondition that both the domain and range has to be continuous. Okay, this is one of the most common cases. Okay, maybe I want to represent a line chart that I have on the x-axis the time and on the y-axis have the behavior of, you know, number of sales of sold products of my shops, okay? A very simple part. If I want to map time on my x-axis, I need to use a scale. Why? Because I want to constrain a time continuous quantities, normally an interval, but we know that time is, can be considered continuous, on a fixed geometrical space. That is the interval of pixels that into my SVG area represent the horizontal direction. Okay, I don't want that one of the time points get outside and get clumped by my area. So independently of how many time instant I have, I want that all of them will be contained into my horizontal space. If here we have a line chart, okay? And so now I have a way to do it. If I use a scale, I can exactly map, as represented here, this story. So I can see how many time interval, time point I have in my table that govern my sold products, and I instruct the library to exactly match this interval on the space that I have available. And now it is not important if the space is 2 pixel or 2000 pixels. I will be granted that all the data element for the time coordinate will be completely contained into the space that I give them, okay? Clearly it is not magic. What I mean that syntactically it will happen. Then probably in the example of 2 pixels I give to you, I will have a graph that is a mess because a human cannot understand anything, okay? But I will never risk that some of my data elements get rendered outside my area. And at that point for me, even for the designer, this will be invisible because those points will get clumped. We already said that the SVG area simply clump whatever exists outside its boundaries. Okay, and so maybe I could be convinced, think about if I have a very outlying point and I don't choose to use a scale. I simply look at the data and say, okay, yes, maybe I have a amount of data, I can do it in 200 pixels. Now I simply go do it by hand, and maybe I don't see that one of them is very outlying and very much, much bigger than the rest of the data. And at that point, it will get destroyed by the clumping behavior of the area. And so I lose maybe a very important information because I have an element that does not respond to my distribution, not because I can't, but because I created wrongly this mapping simply by looking. On the other hand, structuring this behavior, I have this guarantee. And I have this guarantee, interestingly, general. If now the range change, or if now the domain change, the mapping get reaccommodated. I only have to communicate this change, okay? So I have to reevaluate the extent of the range or of the domain, but by simply invoking, maybe they are, we see here how, we will see briefly how it is governed in code. Okay, let's take the more simple scale, the linear one. Okay, normally I want to create it, and we said that it is an object and a function, so I want a clear handler of it. I don't want to lose it. It's not anymore a functional behavior like we saw before, in which we simply do something, we have the side effect, and we go along. Now, this time I'm creating something that I could reuse more time into my code. So I want to retain them. And so for a scale, we always need a variable that will contain it. And then it will work, as I told you, both as a variable, so an object, and as a function. So I can invoke it on something. How it is created? We define the variable, we call the d3.scaleLinear in this case. This is the original family function that governs all the family. And we go specifying two properties for it, dot domain and dot width. Those normally are two bidimensional arrays that only in the continuous case must contain the minimum value and the maximum value of the extent that we are passing, and that represent visually Dos, okay? Again, think about it. Let's take our original story. We are drawing this line chart. I have now my axis, my x-axis that I want to draw. And even before drawing the axis, I want to govern this mapping. I want that my time elements, my time instant in which I checked the product sold, are completely contained into the horizontal space that I'm giving you this visual code. Where do I put them? Where do I take those quantities? This scale will be a scale that goes from a data domain, my time interval, to a visual domain, my horizontal space, my horizontal coordinate of my area. Let's focus on the data. Now I need simply to go to the column or to the complex hierarchy that I could have of objects, reobtain the vector of the time instant, so on a single attribute, and extract from it the minimum value, the maximum value. And this will be completely dependent on the semantic of the column that I take. In a time will be the earliest possible moment and the latest possible moment. In a normal quantity will be the minimum and maximum and so on. But I can completely do it in code. I simply have to refer to my data, extract what I want to map. I already choose one to map here during the design phase. I know that I want a line chart with something on the x-axis, so I know this mapping. And I will create a piece of code that will extract to me this extent. Okay, so this extent can be dynamically processed at any moment on the data that I have. And I need to pass it as a parameter of the domain properties of the scale, the linear scale that I'm creating. Think for the moment on the range. The range to a certain extent is even easier. Why? Because I already created the layout even dynamically. So now I know how much space I have. Eventually I can even read the directory from my code, okay? I can go taking the SVG area, reading what is maybe its horizontal width, maybe subtracting the margin if I need to subtract, and obtain the exact extent on which I want them mapped in terms of absolute position. Again, an absolute position that is valid here because we worked well here. So eventually I could have an absolute positioning. I don't have to remember that maybe this part is here, so I need to start obtaining strange values for horizontal that maybe go from 800 pixels to 1000 pixels. I don't have to combat with this problem. For me, it will always be absolute, and then the library will go rendering and considering the layout will know exactly what to do, okay, without having to specify those very bad numbers. So here, for example, I could have, in this case it was general, a range that go from 0 to 720 or whatever. Again, it's not to be static. I can read those quantities and obtain immediately the available space that I choose. Eventually I can even choose to modify it if, for example, I want to use less area or maybe to use more or whatever. After I have defined it, I have this scale attempt. And normally, I want even to say, we will see in a moment, that what we see here, compact, normally instead happens in different part of the code for the domain and the range, okay? It has to do with what we saw at the end of last lessons. In our visualization, when we render it, we will have a moment in which we don't have the data. Why? Because the data have a time to get loaded, or because maybe the data are not even loaded at that moment. Maybe they will be loaded later, maybe because it will be too long to load all the data that I need at the beginning. So normally I have always, when I reason, those two instants, an instant in which I only have the visual space and an instant in which finally I get data to use. What I mean is that, having defined the layout, this quantity in the visual space will be much easier to get than the other one. Why? Because this quantity does not depend on the data. This quantity depends only on what the designer chooses to give space for. Okay, so as not the need to have the data loaded to being evaluated. On the other hand, this quantity without data is meaningless. I will get an error. And so what I want to say that eventually stress the double nature of the scales is that the double nature of the scale exists also because scales usually get parameterized for domain and range in two different parts of the code. Usually their geometric extent are defined immediately. So it is in the beginning of the code as an initialization step after having defined the layout and the areas. And both the layout and the areas can be defined without any data loaded because it's just part of the geometric appearance. While instead, the domain are usually added to the scale after the data has been finished the loading. Why? Because they need to get computed. We don't have them static at the beginning. We cannot rely on static assumption on what is the extent of my data, because maybe I am user A and maybe I have a month of data. Then comes user B and have a year of data, or maybe 10 years of data. And I cannot simply say that 1 month will be enough and I can take those quantity of 1 month immediately. Would be no meaning of it, okay? For those reasons, interestingly, we don't need necessarily to define all the property of a scale during its creation, but we can create a subset of those elements, in particular, maybe only the range, and defer the application of the domain during, no, after the data load. Please consider that for us, as we saw last time, doing something after the data loading means that that code has to be included in the callback function that is linked to the data loader instruction. If you remember last time we saw that the D3.csv loader that loaded a set of data and have a callback function that took the parameter rows in which the data were loaded, and that guaranteed us that if we write code inside that callback function, those codes will be synchronous to the full loading of the data, okay? So that would mean that the range could be outside of that code blocks, could be even before the code blocks, while the definition of the domain must absolutely be inside that code. Interestingly, after we have to remember that we cannot use a scale that has not defined both those quantities. What I mean is that we can create at the beginning with a single quantity. It will work, but we cannot immediately use it. To use it, we need to have defined even the second one. Otherwise, you can understand that the mapping would be non-existent if one of them is not clear. After those elements in different parts of the code have been specified, the scale is fully defined and can be used. And its usage is very simple. It's like a normal mapping function. So I take the name of the variable that I give to the scale defined, I pass to it an element of the domain, and I get as a result the corresponding continuous, in this case, element of the range. Okay, so I pass a time interval and I obtain the exact pixel, the exact x coordinate of the pixel on which it must be represented into my code, into my horizontal part of the line chart. Okay, and I can invoke it out whatever I like. I can even pass it, and it is interesting, as the data that I want to pass in a dynamic attribute settings, okay? Where I read the data from my data set, I read the D, I pass D inside the scale, obtaining the corresponding pixel space, and I use the pixel attribute at this moment to maybe, in this case, define the position of the element, okay? If I need to represent those data points, now I'm able to obtain for all my data, not only the extent of the time interval, but for all the time interval that I have there, a consistent pixel value on the horizontal that will define one of the two coordinates of their position. We will see example. Interestingly, we don't have only a pure linear behavior in the quantitative scale. We can have even, as you can imagine, different mapping mathematical functions. And the very two common one, but there are even more than that. The squared scale, that as the name say, returns the square operation on the range. So given an element of the domain, return the squared value in the range. And the log scale, that is even more interesting, because for example, it can allow us to define log behavior that normally in line chart is very useful when we have very extended data domain. So maybe data domain that go from unit to millions of units and we need to represent them together. At that point, our visual space, if treated linearly, could be very bad because the very highest value will simply squeeze the low values, okay? And we could not appreciate anymore the single element. Take an example, if you go to a whatever chart and start comparing people of which incomes are billions of dollars with people of which incomes are maybe units of dollars or maximum tens of dollars, you will see how the highest value completely make invisible the low one, because the linear mapping clearly give more space to them. Log scale, for example, is a way to avoid it. Okay, why? Because at that moment I have clearly quantized area that work as a log. So try to eventually smooth and reduce the effect of highest value with respect to low one, because the log function do that and do that with a different magnitude. And immediately I have band of element, which inside its band, the band of unit, the band of tens, the band of hundreds, the band of thousands, the millions are immediately completely visible. And I'm able to interpret that if a point jump from a band to the next is simply not moving little of a little quantity, but is moving of a big quantity because it's changing order of magnitude inside its point. Nonetheless, it's useful. This behavior normally, if not present, would be instructed by us. For example, computing by us the log value for all the data, and maybe creating a new column that have the log value of it, that would be stupid because maybe my data are huge and maybe this is inefficient. Instead, if I choose to exploit scale by choosing the right scale, and we will have different, in this case, the log one, I'm able in real time during the evaluation of the scale to compute this mapping. They will be in memory, they will be not saved anywhere, but they will be retainable by the scale itself. And it is quite interesting, exactly for line charts and maybe bar charts, where log scales are pretty much commonly used. Additionally, we said that domains and range has to be extracted dynamically. Okay, we can do it by ourselves, or we can eventually exploit a quickest way to extract them. Okay, through the usage of three main functions that are the d3.min, d3.max, and d3.extend function. They do exactly what we expect them to do and allow to pass from static and, you know, quite never good assignment of those values to a dynamic one, in which here, for example, we have a vector of properties that maybe is numbers, and we extract from it the maximum value or the minimum value. Here is not but similar. Or directly the extent, so directly the vector of minimum and maximum that we need to pass to the scale. Okay, here is the other example. And in doing it, we obtain a dynamic extraction of the extent that eventually could vary during time, every time the definition of the scale is re-evaluated. Okay, maybe because new data come and there is a function that recomes the redraw the update of the equation. Quite easy concept though. As already told you, again, even this example is not trivial as the one before, but little trivial because it is just a vector. Right now we could have a table or whatever. And so we will rely to accessors of the table. Where we said that accessors are elements that allow us to specify a specific property of a set, a data set that we pass. So let's say that our data set is more complex than the one that we saw before. And for example, we can define an accessor function that is normally a function that could have whatever name and is based on the data that we are looking and does not nothing more than returning the name of the properties that is in our data. Okay, maybe this is time, or maybe this is number of sold product, whatever it is, it's not important. Okay, and we see an example here on how to combine them together. In this piece of code, we define a variable x, we want to pass us a log scale. We define the domain as the computation of the D3 dot extents of what? Of our original data set, however it is, maybe very complex, and the accessor function, the value accessor function that we define it here. Okay, this piece of code is static. Can be wrote at the beginning of the code, and it is simply an accessing function. It does not load anything. It simply say when you invoke this function on the data, it will look for the value property here that is specified in this part. Okay, but whatever data we have, we could have different. And when we invoke it, we pass the D3 extent this time not only on the data which we want to invoke like here, but we pass the data in this object, and we pass the accessor that we want to get applied on the data. And it will return, in this case, only the column that has a label, the value label, okay? Whatever it is. So again, we see that, and it is a very important aspect, when we go to define visual mapping, we don't want to use the full data set all the time. We want to slice it with respect to what we need to use. Okay. At the beginning of this mini course, we started attaching data to whatever, even if the data were very complex. Right now, we have a way to use a real time portion of the data to define the mappings. On the other hand, scales allow even. A little advanced behavior that sometimes is good and sometimes is bad, and it all depends on how we use it. In the case of linear scale, these get the form of the interpolators. What are interpolators? Interpolators are implicit behavior of the library, in this case. That if instructed to create a linear scale, try to obtain this scale even where it's not explicitly defined. Let's take the first example. Here we have again a linear scale. We have again the same numeric domain, but this time we don't have a numeric range, or at least not an explicit numeric range. This is a vector, but if we look at it as it is, it seems a vector of two colors. Okay, one is still blue and the other is brown. Okay, so we could say, okay, but this has not to be a linear scale because one of the parameter is continuous, that is the domain, but the other does not seem continuous at all. It seems categorical, it seems discrete. But given the fact that we have defined the scale as linear, and already told you that a linear scale mandate to have both those quantity continuous. So I cannot have a linear scale between a continuous and a discrete quantity by definition. An implicit interpolator that is inside the library, depending on what we pass here, try to interpret this not anymore as a discrete vector, but as continuous one. So essentially what it does, it computes the distance between those two colors in the RGB color space. In this case, it is only, it's not the only one, probably already saw it, that there exists different color space, and if not, you will see in a future lesson. But in this case, it takes the RGB color space and transform this two value vector into a continuous vector of all the shades of color that connect those two points into the space. As that space at that moment becomes a geometric space, okay, where a continuous set of color is defined and a continuous distance between two colors can be defined. In fact, if we call it as it is here, those scale into onto one of the elements of the domain, it will return us a very precise color that is an interpolation between those two, here expressed in RGB, in hexadecimal version of RGB color space, that eventually will be a whatever combination between those two. There could be even a very different color depending on how they get combined. And you see that, for example, this behavior could behave very wrong if we were interested in having just two colors, because it will create a lot of them for us. And it will be unwanted, maybe, for us. But on the other hand, if instead this is what I want, maybe I'm not able, or I was not able to define a color scale explicitly, but maybe I'm able to define the extent in a color space in which I want, that eventually is a segment, okay? If you use a PowerPoint or whatever, and sometimes you try to use the color picker, you will see that this is a very classic, one of the classic representation of RGB color space with a circle with all the kind of use of color. At that point, it saves me time, because I don't have to define a color scale that is again a scale in D3, but I can, or maybe I'm doing it now, but I can simply define the extent of the range of this color scale that I want to use. And the library implicitly will do the job for me without having me to define explicitly how it must be. The other example is done on the string. It's quite similar to the one before. Here I'm representing my range, not anymore as absolute values, like it was here, integer, but as string. Sometimes it can happen. Maybe I have to read them from some other software, or maybe even by browser. And we know that in web technology, a lot of the value that we read as strings themselves are not fully typed, okay? And so maybe I read 0px and 720px, that in themselves, for a normal, things are strings, so nothing can be defined in terms of continuous behavior between two strings, at least not naive. The library is able, in this case, again, with another interpolator that is already inside the scale behavior, to understand that when the px suffix is present, it means a value in pixel, and so it automatically extracts it, cast it on their integer number or real float number, and again, treat this range as a continuous interval, in this case, a continuous pixel interval. So similar example, this one, but this one is related to a distance and this one is related to a color. Both of them are quite useful. At the same time, maybe I don't see it here. Let me check if it is later. At the same time, another interpolator that exists by definition and that sometimes can be very dangerous is the fact that in order to be resilient, the scales allow us to pass to them even values that are outside the domain. Not in terms of completely outside, meaning that they are nothing to do with the domain. So maybe the domain is numerical and I pass a categorical, this I cannot do. But maybe The domain is, in this case, between 12 and 24, and I pass the 40 value here. I don't invoke x of 16, but I invoke x of 4, okay? That is completely very far on the right extreme. Normally, we should expect that the scale should not work because the element is out of bounds. Normally, in a classic fully typed language program, we will receive an out of bound exception because we are invoking something outside the domain in which it is defined. In D3, this is not the behavior. Interestingly, you will obtain a value of the range that will be consistent with what you pass, but that will probably even itself be external to the extent. In this case, maybe it will be a color that is outside the segment that connects these two, maybe in another part of the color space. And we will not get alerted of this, okay? So eventually, maybe we could have that if it goes wrong, we will get a very different color that is not in between the segment that put together, that connects still blue with brown, but we will not get an error. So it will get computed, even if the value is not admissible, okay? This is something that sometimes get at end, because maybe if we wrongly define the scale, we don't get that our system crashes, our system is resilient and try to behave consistently to the mapping that we define it. Other time, we could have some predictable results that we did not specify for it, because it is not, there is no alerting on these violations of the mapping. So eventually, in this case, the interpolator try to infer the behavior of the scale outside the domain interval on which the scale has been defined, like considering an enlarged interval, okay, as they want, with, I want to say, unpredictable, or most of the time for the design, unpredictable behavior. So we cannot anticipate how it will work. Similar, we can even compound scale, linear scale. What I mean? If we need a different behavior with respect to a different interval of the same domain, instead of having to define no boring multiple scales, we can define a compounded one, okay? In the compounded one, we does not specify anymore only the two extent of the interval, but we specify all the extent of the intervals we want to say. Essentially, this reads that here we have an interval that goes from minus 10 to 0, and then we have an interval that goes from 0 to 100, okay? Effectively making this domain a domain composed of two different intervals, the negative one up to minus 10 and the positive one up to 100. On the other hand, the same is valid for the range. Even the range have specified those three intervals. For these three values that specify two intervals. The first one that goes from red to white, and the second one that goes from white to green. Okay? And now it is interpreted it. Those two quantities must match exactly. So we need to have the same number of intervals for the domain and the range, otherwise it will be not possible to specify this behavior. And in this case, we see that the swath scale define a color scale that goes from red to white when the value of the domain are negative, up to minus 10, and then get from white to green while the value of the domain are positive, ranging from 0 to 100, okay? Normally, if you think about it, up to what we said to now, we should have defined two scales. Maybe the first one would have been called the X negative and would have mapped minus 10, 0 to red, white range. And the second one, they would have been X positive. They would have mapped 0, 100 domain to white, green range. Instead of having this long and verbose definition, in those cases, So in the cases in which we can split a scale into intervals, that is very important, keeps the semantics of the mapping, we can compact the story by defining just one compounded scale that, defined in this way, will model all the story. It will reduce the number of scales that we need to use to just one, and will be reduced the line of code that we have to write. And it will work consistently, as I told you. On the other hand, another completely different kind of scale family are the ordinal scales. Okay? The ordinal scales are reported in this slide, map the completely opposite condition. So where both domain and range are discrete quantities. Normally we should refer to categorical, they usually are the most common encountered when talking with discrete. But please consider that discrete could even mean quantized quantities, okay? So elements that in their linear nature are continuous, but that they are representing instead fixed interval of them without any concept of going to a continuous granular. An example we have it here. Let's say that maybe in our line chart or whatever, we have a column that is categorical, maybe reporting to us the grade of satisfaction that a consumer had by buying a product. Okay, that could be maybe in the American standard, maybe the number of stars, for example, is another example of categorical elements, and or the category themselves. Okay, and we want them mapped in a scale. Okay, where maybe to those grades that are letters are maybe assigned some weights. Okay, that instead are numerical and maybe I use it later to do whatever evaluation, summary evaluation of this story. Here we have the case in which we want a one-to-one mapping between these. We don't want the behavior of before. We don't want the scale to infer something and or to have continuity. So for us, it does not exist alpha split two, or we don't have a clear concept of the distance that exists between A and B. We just know that A and B are different, but we don't have a distance function that allow us to go from A to B. And for this reason, we cannot use a linear scale, and we use normally an ordinal one that eventually take the ordinal domain and the discrete domain, the discrete range, and what it does is simply a one-to-one mapping in the order in which they appear. Okay, so for example, if I call x of b, it will return to me 10, because 10 is the second element in the range and b is the second element in the domain, and this will be the most easiest of the mapping. And again, it asks us, in its pure behavior, to have an exact matching between domain and range. The second part that it demonstrates, for example, is that this could be this one, an example of using a scale from a data domain to a data range, not to a visual space range. Okay, in this case, those are not pixels, maybe those are weights that we want to fastly retrieve during maybe another computation that compute the summary aggregation of them. So maybe do some magic by the number of occurrence of those categories with respect to the weight that are given by those categories to compute an average summary of the satisfaction of our consumers, for example. And this has nothing to do with representing them. Okay? This, for example, has to speed up a computation. It works like a map for central exam. That is exactly what it is then. And it demonstrates that in D3, as we said at the beginning, scales can be used even to go from a data domain to a data domain, okay? And not only necessarily from a data domain to a visual range. On the other hand, the same is true on the opposite case. I could even use scale maybe to transform a visual coordinate system to another visual coordinate system. Maybe I want to transform the pixel values into the EM values or whatever other things I want to do. It's not important, okay? What is important is that I can use them as, in, or as functions that are completely auxiliary to my job, and not necessarily have only the task to mapping my data to my visual space. We said that this is an explicit mapping and it works best if this matching is exact. But it does not mean that it needs to be exact. Okay, so what happened in the case in which the cardinality of the domain is different from the cardinality of the range, or the opposite? The answer is quite simple. The minimum length of the two will be the one that command the mapping. Okay, so let's take this example. Here we have the tree scale ordinal called on a variable that is called skin category 20. You don't know still what it is, but I told you now that it is a reserved co-ordinal color scheme of the tree that in the end is a vector of 20 exact color that represent the 20 most diverse color existing. Okay, due to literature. Eventually, I want even to say that this concept is getting more and more surpassed, so there are a lot of questions if it is true semantically. So those are really the 20 most diverse colors, but it is a collateral consideration. For us, what it is important is that get transformed in a vector of 20 ordinal colors, okay, in the RGB space. And it represents a contracted form of specifying the range of it. Okay, so the skin category 20 in this scale is the range, even if it's not explicitly defined. Okay, this is a way that we will see how to treat default scheme, color scheme inside it. And so, in order to complete this scale, we need just to define the domain. Okay, and we want to pass to the domain the same values as before. That at this moment are 5, are not 20. We don't have 20 categories to attach to those 20 colors. We just need 5. We are not interested in how many we get. Okay. How does it work? This mapping at this point. The mapping remains one to one. It doesn't change its behavior, but it remains one to one in a very specific way of working. The way of working is to compute the minimum extent of those two intervals that clearly is this one. This one will be the one that will govern the map. What we mean? A will be given the first element of the skin category, to be the second, and so on, up to the fifth. They will get the fifth. From the sixth to the 20th of the remaining one, no association will be. Okay, so they will not be used. It is interesting. It's very interesting because it is resilient to us, so we don't have to govern the match. Okay? And eventually, it allows us nonetheless to use domain that are or range that are bigger in cardinality than the equivalent domain or range. And it is resilient in future usage of this. What I mean? Let's say that right now I have these 5 categories, but maybe tomorrow this system, for whatever reason, maybe 100 years from now, we add the E evaluation, okay? So we want even to express the very bad behavior, not just the E. The very moment that we add them here, the scale resiliently will simply add the sixth matching direct element to its behavior, okay? And it will be done transparently, meaning that we have a buffer in this. Eventually we can get to 20 category without having to redefine anything. Okay, why? Because the part of the range that are not used now Stators ready eventually to be used if additional element will be added to the domain. Okay, and this will be quite good for us, because if you take an example, I can always load the skin category 20 directly when I have to work with categorical data. And the only thing that I have to check is that the category that I have are less than 20. Okay, and then if there are two, it will work fine, giving me the first two colors. If there are 10, it will be the first 10 color, and so on. I don't have to, again, having to define a different scale any moment, maybe my cardinality of data changes. On the other end, I want to say that the mapping stay one-to-one, so it does not do any magic in giving more value to the same domain value, more color to the same one or whatever. Okay, this is quite important, because for example the opposite will be complicated. If I have a 21 category and 20 color, the last category will not get visualized, will be visualized without color, because the scale at that moment doesn't know what to do anymore. Finally, in this part, it's represented an example on how we can evaluate during runtime, maybe in the console or maybe in the code, our scale is configured. Okay, so if we take the name of the scale and invoke on it the domain function this time, or the range function, we get as a result the domain and the range that the scale is currently using. Okay, sometimes it can be useful both for debugging, so try to understand how the scale got parameterized during our work, and both because sometimes maybe we want to read it to pass that value or that vector to other part of the code. So again, exploiting the object nature, the double nature of the scales, I can obtain its parameters. Where can it be used? It is used here. For example, we saw many examples of which an ordinal scale can be used to link color scales to categories that we have in the data. The example that we saw before is this one. This is exactly the scheme 20 color schema. There is even a scheme category 10 that instead takes only the first initial use, while this one they are split in dark and light version, and eventually exist even variation on the theme, okay, for categorical color. Additionally, we I don't know if already got presented to you, eventually we'll reinforce it. We provide a particular resource that is a little tool called Color Viewer 2 that allow to play a little with how to create ordinal color scales, so only ordinal, not continuous, and normally very well used or best used for geographic data, even if some of those vectors are even useful for other kind of visual encoding, that allow to obtain different color vector than the one that are basically provided by the library. So normally the original one provided are state of the art one, even if some of them starting to get more in discussion lately. But at the same time, this tool allows to create your own custom one, still following state of the art, so not simply inventing color that could not have a property good to be. The same exists for continuous color scale. Here are just a very little example of them, like the viridis or the rainbow. Those are directly created scales. There are in this case continuous one, where you simply take already them and use them as they already have a defined scale. So if I call d3.interpolate viridis of t, I'm obtaining continuous color scales, where the only thing that I have to remember is that the value of the domain that I pass cannot be whatever extent must be normalized between 0 and 1 in order for the scale to work. Okay, but this is normally a step that given the minimum and maximum is trivial to obtain the normalized version between 0 and 1. So quite easy. And at that moment, we're still exploiting this behavior. Where is it? We are still exploiting the linear scale behavior, but now we have a set of scales, color scale in particular, already defined for us. And many of them are state of the art again. So some of them I used maybe to represent bivariate distributions, that are best exploited maybe to represent continuous values, maybe the rainbow scale or the other, and you will find a lot of them. Okay, these are just the first two that I found, but in the API page of B3 there are a lot of them, and you can look for the best one for you. Nonetheless, we need to remember that again they govern a mapping between a data domain and a visual attribute. You already know the color can be used as a visual encoding attribute. The color scales that you see here is exactly created to ease the creation of this map. This eventually in the ordinal familiar scales, and probably I think that this will be the last slide for today, we can obtain the two missing spots. So we saw continuous to continuous, we saw discrete to discrete, and we can ask us what to do when I have mapping that are discrete to continuous or continuous to discrete. Those can exist, absolutely. In that case, normally it exists additional two families that are normally ordered, okay, in nature. Why? Because at least one of the element is ordinal, okay, so they cannot be modeled as a linear one for the interpolator behavior that we saw before, otherwise the interpolator will try to transform everything into continuous story. But that allow to govern those two exact differences. One is the scale point and the other is the scale band. Okay, so as you can see here, we take in this case a discrete domain, and we want to map it to a continuous range in this case. Okay, and for doing it, and this is very useful sometimes for bar chart, we can use the scale point family of scales or the scale bound family of scales. Both of them do something very similar. The first one gives us the exact position for which each of the element of the ordinal domain get represented into the continuous range. Okay, so eventually allow us, for example, to get the origin or a reference point for where to draw something that respect this one. The scale band or its various form that eventually can be different allow eventually to make it even more specific, so allow us to go specifying the granularity on which we want to get them. Okay, this one will be evenly spaced. Okay, so it will simply go evenly spaced the continuous range return as the 5 points that go back. Here instead we can try to specify even the distance itself. Okay, so at this moment it will not be space filling, okay, because it will not cover the full extent of the continuous range, but it will work in the steps that we define here. Again, it could be used to create more resilient visualization than maybe add bars during its evolution, specifying a fixed width for each of the bars instead of a dynamic one, like here, where if I Now rise the element in the domain, it will get them shorter and shorter, feeding the whole story. Those are design choice, okay? And then each one can do whatever they think is possible. And clearly the same thing can be done from the opposite case. So the case in which we put a continuous domain and we want to map it into an ordinal. Finally, even in this case, for those specific kind of scales, new function exists. For example, return has properties like the width of the band, depending on how we define a band and so on. Okay, and the full API can be consulted into the lab. Eventually, this closes the scales part and today's lessons. Please, as a little homework, try to go looking directly at the API of the 3.js that is in their main page, and specifically the scales part, to see the full extent of scales available. The families are all covered here, but the characteristics of different variations instead are much more rich, and there exists a full specification. And eventually, try to look at least for a couple of them, what kind of sub API is available in order to obtain property or to set property of the scales itself. I close saying that scales govern this mapping, but again, as V3.js fashion app, doesn't do anything like that. When after we have defined the scale, we have a clear definition of how the visual encoding must work, and we have to do it for all the visual attributes that we want to use. We saw example for positioning, we saw example for colors, but it could exist different. If you look at the visual representation, we take a scatter plot, for example, we know that we can govern the two coordinates of the point, but we can govern even the color of the point, we can govern the shape of the point, we can govern the sides of the point, maybe we can govern even the border of the point, okay? Each of them is a visual channel, so for us a visual attribute. For each of them, if it is data driven, we need to specify a scale to specify the data attribute that governs that visual attribute and how it has to do with respect to the matching that we saw. Nonetheless, after we do this mandatory work, still nothing is visible into the visualization. This is a preparatory work that gives the library the rules how things will work for that visual encoding. But again, in themselves, scales does not render anything. Okay? We will see next lesson one of the first rendering elements instead that is governed by a scale. So finally, a visual element of which its rendering must need a scale in order to be implemented, that are axes. So we will close the lessons now. If there are any questions, I didn't see anything on the chat, so no question on the chat. If there are questions, you can ask me now at the end of the lesson, and or otherwise we will stop now. Professor will come today at the usual time, I think it is 1:30, to do the second part instead of the theoretic part of the lesson.